I'm sure you've heard these stories time and time again, each of them with various tales of lost loved ones, broken families, horrific war stories, the list goes on. For me, it's my parents' divorce. That was the last straw, so to speak. No, my belief in God never did dwindle, as I've always believed that he's real, but as for constantly walking with him, that's a different story. I'm like a rubber band that has continuously bounced back and forth. The first time it happened was when I was in my late teens. I was an awkward teenager growing up and never really did fit in with anybody. At all. Not even my own siblings. Part of it had to do with the side effects, or rather, behaviors, left behind from our childhood abuse to which I have no memories of. All I have are fragments, puzzle pieces that don't necessarily go together, which include weird dreams, past emotional triggers, parts of my brain psychologically shut off, all the way up to a copy of the CPS file of my case offering some insight as to what could have happened. It's been frustrating to say the least. Poking around in the dark trying to deal with an issue you're not fully knowledgeable about nor fully understand the ramifications that came from it. Being very socially awkward, this made it even more difficult to connect with other people, much more my peers in church. I would go to open my mouth about my struggles only to have people stare at me. I got so fed up with church after not only being made to go, but also because no one really seemed to care nor had the maturity to really help me work through with what I was dealing with. I really wanted to toss the Bible and everything associated with it out the frickin' window just to be done with it. Plus all the gossip and backstabbing that happened at a particular church I was going to, not to mention the horrible treatment my family got due to certain circumstances, was enough for me to give all of it the finger. This lasted for a while, up into my early 20s with me still fighting my parents about church and moving out. Let's face it, the process of me growing up is not normal and never has been. Too many times have I been lumped into the same box as my siblings with certain things only for there to be fights. Word of the wise to parents, don't assume that each kid you have is going to grow up the same way or have the same process as the next one. You'll have less trouble understanding them that way. Anyway, I had to take an alternate route to moving out, which consisted of me going to school in an entirely different state, which I had never done before. This was a long process to get started, as I had to write a few letters, be put on a waiting list of 8 months, meet with a recruiter, the whole deal. It was during this process, 4 months before I actually did move out, that my sister passed away suddenly. I still struggled to walk with God at that time too, but I never did blame God for my sister's death, nor did I get angry because he didn't prevent it. Her death was sudden, with the details surrounding it still being very sketchy and kept hidden. A ruling had been given closing the case. Myself, along with other family members, know the ruling never fit, considering how my sister was. Still, I never did blame God for it, as I understand the concept of free will and that when we disobey or make poor decisions, we must accept the consequences of our actions. What my sister had decided to do the night she died was of her own volition, therefore turning into her own undoing. I do remember having a dream 3 days after she died. There was a small casket in the middle of a circular room. Who lay inside was my biological mother, who was responsible for my abuse. I believe I closed my eyes or looked away for a few moments. Looking back, my sister lay in her place as my biological mother walks out of the room. The meaning to me is still unknown, but at best, it seems as though my sister traded places with her. Never once did I blame God for what had happened, nor was that a reason for walking away. It still didn't help though, and only added to the weights I was already carrying. When it was finally time for me to leave for trade school, I had a hard time still trying to come to terms with my sister's death. The first few months of me being by myself wasn't easy. I had never been so far away from my family before, on top of one of the students' baby had passed away while I was there. I remember people going around asking for donations of money. I gave what I felt was on my heart to give. I made my first donation and then sat back down in my seat. One of my uncles had given me some extra cash before I left, so I had quite a bit. As I sat there, the people taking donations left to move on to another classroom. Something inside of me told me to give them more, so I got up and walked out looking for the three girls carrying their large yellow envelope. Once I found them, I gave them another amount. I went back to my own classroom trying not to break down afterward. Someone had asked me if I was okay. I explained that I just lost my sister and that I was having a hard time with it. The young woman just losing her kid was an emotional trigger. A few minutes later, the girls returned to pull me out into the hallway. I was thanked being told that the second amount I gave was the last bit their friend needed to bury her child. I spoke with them briefly before they went on their way. Even as I was struggling during that time too, I still believe that I heard from God. There would be quite a few more situations where this happened to be the case during my stay at that trade school. It's where I met my husband too. That's of course a story within itself for another time. I did try to walk away from God while I was attending this trade school. I didn't go to church, stopped reading my Bible. I felt like I had to find myself without having any sort of religious or any other influence attached. Suffice to say, that didn't work. It seemed like God's signature was everywhere telling me that he was still there. I had a couple of interesting arguments about my belief in God while attending. Arguing with my roommate about religious beliefs, she was my friend for a small time and reminded me quite a bit of my deceased sister. Our disputes got verbally explosive as she would take her anger out on me from when her and her mom, who was a quote-unquote good witch, were constantly stoned by the Christians in their town. I was told stories of her and her mom would constantly get harassed or rocks thrown at them due to them being wicked. I hated those fights and it seemed it turned into a spiritual battle at times. There were many times where I'd run the fights by my dad and would ask for advice as to what I should do. Suffice to say, our friendship ended and the last room we shared, she left. I remember her last words to me as she stormed out. No one's going to care when you're dead, bitch. I remember sitting there thinking, getting the impression that these were words that someone had said to her, and she was trying to wound me with them. I was already dating my husband, who was my boyfriend at the time, so for her to try and hurt me with them made no sense. I was told many stories of how she used to be a stripper of some sort, had a boyfriend that was possessed, and that she would have to paint crosses on him to calm him down, to family members abusing her. My roommate was also bipolar, so her constant mood swings were really unpredictable. Anyway, it was rather uncomfortable and I had started to hear whispers of other people having issues with her as well. Then there were arguments with a guy nicknamed Radio Tom who turned out to be a Satanist. Those were fun. Not really. When I first met the guy, I felt like there was something off about him. From his eating habits to rumors of him hacking into the system to change his overall grades, which, by the way, I never saw proof for, I just felt really uncomfortable being around him. I remember having a conversation with him and another friend of ours about God and religion when the topic of evolution came up. Tom looked dead at me, asking if I was embarrassed for having come from nothing. First off, I don't see how that question is offensive, but there was more to what he was asking. The question itself felt ominous. I responded sternly that I came from the hand of God and walked out. That conversation still gives me the creeps. It's a common question that atheists ask when discussing evolution and our supposed origins of sharing a common ancestor with monkeys. Still, it seemed as though he was asking if I was ashamed of where I originally came from in regards to my past, which to me is still a mystery. The feeling that was in there and how he was when the question was asked after I went back down left me really disturbed. I used to get into biblical arguments all the time, whether it was in person or online. Thankfully, it's rare when this happens as it's become too much of a headache. It's not my job to change people's minds to begin with. People will decide for themselves. I will still stand my ground though. The point of these stories is to show that I wasn't able to distance myself from God for very long while attending trade school. Like I said, it's been back and forth. After my husband and I left our trade school, graduating together, on time, we moved in together after making some rushed decisions. Our school's administration tried to shove me out early and sandbag him due to them not condoning the students dating. It was a real pain in the butt. What we were promised while there and even before never came to pass due to a large amount of money being misplaced. Anyway, after we started to live together, the two of us got married. Our finances have been tight on and off, so we're not able to see our families really. He's met with mine one time and I've met with his one time. That in itself can cause problems due to us not being fully aware when things fall apart on their end. Multiple situations came up with our families that would result in disputes between us and stressful nights. We were already having disagreements about God and how he was to be incorporated into our marriage. On top of other discrepancies, the family drama was not helping. The final straw for me came a week or so after my great-grandfather died. I actually got to know him for a time and wanted my husband to meet him when we went to go visit my family, but he wasn't strong enough to make the journey. Anyway, I remember being on Facebook one night reading a post from one of my siblings about moving to a different state. I knew they still lived with my parents, so I was rather shocked and excited. Moving out is a big deal in itself, but doing so and jumping state is a whole other ballgame altogether. I called my mom to inquire about it, only to find out my siblings' posts showed the opposite of what was really going on. They weren't moving out, my parents were separating, and my sibling was going with my mother. I was rather stunned and informed that it wasn't supposed to be leaked onto Facebook on top of me being the last child to be told. I wasn't given much details as to why it was happening, just some general explanation. Hanging up, I sat there in disbelief. I just lost another family member and now this is happening. What followed of the next few months was rather suffocating. Everything being pinned on my dad and my siblings cutting off communication with him and getting far away from him as possible and the treatment I got. Being sideshafted for speaking out against it on top of called brainwashed, I was livid. By the next year, I had had enough and cut just about everyone off. Tensions with most of my family grew even more. My mom was given a car by a set of relatives that were leaving for a whole other country. I won't go into it, but I will say, due to stuff being hidden from me after my constant inquiries and finding out after it already happened, another relationship I had went in the garbage. It was also during the same year that I was sent a text during work that my dad had got served divorce papers. It seemed as though my dad and I spoke often before that happened, and afterwards we didn't speak as much. During these past few years, after my parents split, I have felt myself grow more and more tired of my faith. My husband and I have also had some poor treatment from some people after we decided to stop going to church. It was from a couple that was teaching us how to drive. My husband ended up being the only one actually getting taught due to stupid reasons. I got burned because I was considered to be extra work to learn. Anyway, once we stopped going, and in town we saw this couple, either one of them, it was always, "When are you coming back to church?" I absolutely hated the questions, as it was the only thing that was asked. After a while, we didn't see them around town anymore. The very last time I saw them both was during one of my shifts. I greeted them as a sales associate, only to be given a tight-lipped look in silence. They haven't come back since. That was another turnoff I had with church or anyone that went. Also, with the first church, I felt like it was too flashy, and after a small dispute with the pastor, we left. I felt like it was put on my heart to publicly thank the Mr. Couple who donated bikes to both me and my husband before we received our first car. The pastor told me no, and I asked after church why I couldn't. He said it wasn't planned. The two of us did try one more church and actually went for a time, but came to the realization that forcing ourselves to go for the sake of going had no logic behind it. I did try to go a little while longer, get involved in a healing group for women who were mistreated or abused. That didn't last long. It was almost like a feel-good group. Yeah, I would scratch on some deep topics here and there, but at best, it just didn't go where I needed it to, so I kicked it. Tried one more group after that and got tired of how disorganized it was, plus I'm not a morning person. So that went out the door too. There was a couple situations that happened at this church that had me officially kick the bucket with going altogether. The first one had to do with a couple being guest speakers. Their sermon was supposed to be on gifts of the Holy Spirit, and it seemed that I came for the second half of a two-part sermon. Anyway, I had my notebook to jot down things as they spoke. As these two continued to talk, it was obvious to me that they were walking advertisement for how many good deeds they had done for people, along with how they always got people filled with the Holy Spirit, supposedly. There was no discussion on Bible verses and what the Bible actually said about the Holy Spirit at all. The more I sat there and listened, the more irritated I became. My irritation then increased when they started calling out people from the crowd about the things people were struggling with. I'm all for hearing the voice of God and getting messages for people and have done so myself, but what these two were doing felt really off. It's almost like it was rehearsed beforehand, which is not uncommon. A couple of rather famous pastors have been called out and shown to be frauds with their miracles rehearsed. Quite disgusting and misleading if you ask me. One comes to mind, and forgive me, it's been some time since I've read about him. There was one famous pastor who got called out for raising money for a second private jet, as well as his own stage security coming out telling stories of how the people going on stage to get healed got instructed to perform so that the audience would be convinced of the pastor supposedly healing them. Anyway, the couple that was speaking and calling out situations to me came across rehearsed and fake. They afterward called people up to receive the Holy Spirit. That was enough for me to walk out of the room. After sitting there for a minute, listening to the wife tell one woman, "The gift of tongues is not in English. Don't pray in English." I didn't come back in until their praying for people was over. I later ran what happened by my dad, who had the same reaction I did. It was a total joke in my opinion and left me quite pissed. The second situation was more severe. It happened during a sermon where the pastor's wife was preaching. I don't remember exactly what the actual sermon was about, but a certain individual caught my attention. A young gentleman sitting up front, quite excited. As the pastor's wife spoke, the young man tried to interject with a question. He was ignored and then shouted something when the pastor's wife asked a question. She told him no, that he was wrong, and the young man tried to expand on his answer. I could tell the woman was irritated with the man's outburst and pretty much told him to be quiet. I watched him sit there for a minute more before getting up and storming out. The way he did so left me kind of nervous, and I looked around to see if anyone would go after him. No one bothered to. So I sat there for a minute praying about what to do. It was then that I felt God told me to go after him. Quickly, leaving my seat, I met with him near the front door of the church and began to speak with him. During his entire stay, he wouldn't stop moving. From what I could tell, the man was hopped up on some sort of drug. He wouldn't stop twitching. I stated to him that he was self-medicated, as that was the impression I got. Sure enough, he had self-prescribed himself two drugs and was taking them constantly. He told me how he believed someone from another state was coming after him and that no one was willing to help him. I was thanked for speaking with him along with my hand being shaken. The young man also requested that I pass along a message to the pastor telling him that this man wanted to meet with him by himself at 9:30 that evening. Nodding, I told him that I would let the pastor know. The man told me a few more things before pulling out a thick black handgun that had been stuffed in a nearby umbrella holder in the corner. He continued to talk, telling me that it was his only source of defense against the people who were after him as it was held. I quietly listened, not sure how to respond, then watched him mount his bike and pedal away. After that, I made my way back into the main lobby where I was greeted by some of the church's elders. They asked what was said, and I told them about what the man had with him. One of them went as far to even comment, "I thought you went out to rebuke him," causing me to just blink at him. I literally just explained what just happened, and this is the response I get. Not only did it come across really arrogant, but it left me quite angry that no one else bothered to take note of what was really going on. I then told the pastor as to what happened and passed on the message I was left with. The pastor gave me a look, telling me that he was not going to come back to the church after 9. I couldn't blame him, that just sounded like a bad setup. Still, the whole situation left me really disturbed and not wanting to come back. I went home after that, keeping to myself, and waiting for my husband to get off work. Some time had passed. Looking at the clock, it was nearing 9 p.m. I then remembered that there was a store nearby that was in the area and was near closing up shop for the evening. I was quick to give the store a call, alerting the manager to what happened at church and that the man had plans on returning to the area armed around 9:30. I gave them instructions to call the police to escort them out, along with passing my info to the cops. The manager did so. I received a text a little bit later letting me know that her and her fellow worker had made it home safely. I also spoke with an officer that night helping them identify who the man was. Turns out, this was a guy that was known for causing trouble in town and living behind the mall. The police were looking for him and had no idea that he was in possession of a firearm. The officer tried to have me identify the gun, but that was hopeless. Either way, the setup for what could have happened, with everyone in that church building being too absorbed in what was being said instead of paying attention to the man's behavior, left me angry. My thought process was, if people were really paying attention to the spirit, then more people, particularly the elders, would have picked up on the strange behavior I did. Granted, the man's strange behavior was kind of obvious to begin with. With members only looking to rebuke the man, my frustration with church altogether grew. My dislike of church with the various observations I've had of it also pushes me away from God due to me not wanting to be associated with that type of place. Too often do I find myself irritated with these places, as they tend to keep within their own four white walls and don't do a whole lot outside of community work. Now don't get me wrong, I'm sure that there are good churches, but the ones I've been to, I'd rather have my wisdom teeth removed over going back. My second home, now torn, coupled with the bad experiences of my past church goings, really has blown a rather huge hole in my faith. However, I've never been able to abandon God entirely. I try to, and something always pulls me back. I've touched upon struggles with my faith on my channel before, and even did an overhaul of my golden log showing that I didn't care anymore. These days, I find myself bogged down and slightly depressed. There's so much more that I want my chambers to be, and certain things that I've been shown in dreams that I express through my channel that I myself don't fully understand. At this point, I'm not sure what my aim is for myself or my chambers. I just know that I'm feeling that rubber band effect again, with other things being brought to my attention from both the past and present. Where I'm at now, I know is not permanent, and I'm not sure how much longer my stay will be. For now, I guess I'm to follow where I feel myself being led to. As to where that is exactly, I'll just have to keep going to find out.